you to open a Bible. Maybe you didn't bring one today, but there should be one near you in the pew rack right in front of you. And find in the New Testament one of the Gospels, the Gospel of Luke, a little bit about the writer of the Gospel entitled Luke, named for him, is most all of the other writers in our Scripture were Jewish by birth, and Luke was something else. He was what the Bible calls a Gentile. Something else that's interesting about Luke is he was a physician. He was a scientist. He was a medical expert of that day and of that time. And so his insights into Scripture are affected by who he was as a person. There are 11 recorded appearances or occasions of appearances in the Bible of Jesus after the resurrection. The resurrection being that he was dead. He was dead in a tomb. They had prepared his body. They had, to that day in practice, they had embalmed his body. And they put him in a borrowed tomb with a full expectation that he would be like every other man that had ever been born. He'd stay in the grave. But the Bible tells us that Jesus was different. He was both God and man. And the Bible tells us, and I believe this to be true, that on that third day after the passing of time, the power of God raised Jesus back to life. And one of those 11 occasions where he appeared, one place the Bible actually tells us that he appeared to more than 500 people. So there's skeptics, there's cynics that look at this and say, well, I just don't know. In fact, some go so far as to say, I'm not sure. Some are emphatic and say, it's not so. And that's up for you to decide. I gave up on trying to twist people's arms and, impress them with Jesus, other than to say, I am persuaded by the power of what I read in his word and by the impression that the Holy Spirit gives me that I have a personal faith in God through Jesus Christ and that he is alive. I've chosen to call the sermon for the text Along the Way. And something that I know is absolutely true about each and every one of us in here is each of you were born. You have a birth date. You were born. And there's something else that I know that is absolutely true about each of you. It's going to happen one of two ways. The last breath will leave your body, and if there's an expert there, they will make that conclusion. They will pronounce, yep, John, Bill, Ted, Fred's dead. Okay? There's a possibility, however, based upon what the Bible says, that if you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you are still drawing breath, your heart is beating, on that day, with a trumpet blast, Christ is going to come again. He's coming again, supernaturally, gloriously, bodily coming again. And with him, he will bring the soul or the spirit of those that have already died in Christ. And in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the Bible says, we will be caught up in the air. So, along the way, you were born, you've had how many birthdays? I'm not asking you to tell me, but you've had birthdays, and I imagine you're like most of us, you're looking forward to the next one. Because if you stop having birthdays, but I've got to talk about somebody that's here, and maybe I'm mistaken, but I've been told that there's one man in this church, he's a deacon, and perhaps he doesn't know his actual birthday. That he has maybe more than one birthday with a birth certificate. Am I right, Jim Kelso? Yeah. So you know what? This is what I can tell about you. You won't remember your birthday. Okay? You were there. You fully participated in it. But it wasn't something that you decided. Someone decided for you. And bless your heart, it wasn't your mother or your father that decided for you to be born. It was God who is the creator. And we all have a birthday. But not only will you have a birthday, not to be morose or morbid, but you've got a death date. It's out there. I'm not suggesting you hasten that day at all, but leave it to God to decide when that time comes. But along the way, like these two that we're going to read about in Luke's gospel, along the way, you're going to have experiences. You're going to have encounters. You're going to hear things. You're going to read things. You're going to talk to people. And you're going to find a friend perhaps like, well, let's just read out of Luke's gospel, chapter 24. It's a rather lengthy passage, and I might even interrupt myself along the way. Now that same day, two of them, these are two disciples. A disciple is one who has experienced Christ, believes in Christ, is a follower of Christ, but they're leaving Jerusalem, and they're trying to figure out what in the world have they just seen, what have they felt, and what's their understanding. And it says they were on their way to a village called Emmaus, which is about 7 miles from Jerusalem. Together they were discussing everything that had taken place. I like verse 15 if you're reading along. And while they were discussing and arguing, they were arguing. You know, did to, did not. Well, this is what I saw. Well, I didn't see that. This is what I saw. I want you to know this. Along the way, God will allow you to stand shoulder to shoulder with someone else. They'll have a glorious supernatural spiritual experience, and you're standing there saying, I have no earthly idea what just happened. Something happened, I didn't know that. Or conversely, it might be they're standing there, and you'll say, did you see that? And they'll say, I didn't see a thing. And you'll say, I did. And they say, oh, you couldn't have. I was right there, and I didn't see the same thing. It's that kind of arguing over what we want to call both objective and subjective experience. And that's how we often make our decisions, based on what we've experienced. And that's what these two characters were doing. They were arguing with each other about what they thought they saw or what they thought they knew. And while they were discussing and arguing, Jesus himself came near and began to walk along with them. Now, if Christ be risen and the Bible be true, the Bible says he is now at the right hand of the Father. And while he sits at the right hand of the Father, he said, I must go away that another come, one like him who is the Holy Spirit. So even today, you can be walking along, going someplace, having an argument. And I don't know about you, but my arguments sometimes get pretty elevated. Elevated, they get loud, emotional, they get, you know. And even in those moments where you're demanding that you be heard, and not only that you be heard, that you shout down that other person, the Holy Spirit can come into a relationship and begin to speak. He speaks. But they were prevented from recognizing him. Again, just an admonition. God is at work even in this place, in this hour. You might say, well, I don't see it, I don't feel it, I don't hear it. You can be assured he is at work, but you're prevented from recognizing it. You're prevented from recognizing it because in the past you said, I'm not going to believe in Jesus. You're prevented from recognizing it because as a Christian, now hear this, as a Christian, you have allowed sin to come into your life so that your heart is hardened and you don't recognize the spiritual work of God through the Holy Spirit. But then Jesus spoke to them, what is this dispute that you're having with each other as you're walking? And they stopped walking and they looked. And then there's a word of interest there. It says they were discouraged. The facts of life discourage them. I don't know about you, but along the way in life, do you not find moments of discouragement? Relationships don't turn out the way you thought they should. People disappoint you. You lose a job or you get a job that you thought was going to be more, and it's not more. And as you live life and get older, you find some days you look at life, you look in the mirror, you're no longer youthful like these children or like a teenager, and you just look at life and you say, I'm discouraged because of life. But there was more to this conversation. Listen and look. The one named Cleophas answered Jesus and said, are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that happened there in these days? And Jesus, being the masterful teacher, he asked them the question and lets the person speak. That's what I love about Christ. He's compassionate. And he'll allow you to tell him what you think. Go ahead and tell him sometime. Just say, God, let's have a conversation. Here's what I think. I think that the scientists are right. I think by absolute chance that out of nothing, there was this big bang. And as a result, there are more than 7 million people on the face of the earth. And I believe it was all an accident. None of us are the same. We don't all look the same. We don't all speak the same language. I think we're here by accident. But then in a fair conversation with God, you have to listen to what he has to say. And his word will tell you something like this. In your mother's womb, he knew you. He placed you there. And he has an idea about you. And he has a desire for you. Jesus said, what things? So they said to him, the things concerning Jesus Nazareth, who is a prophet, powerful in action and speech before God and all the people. and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him, but we were hoping that he was the one who would redeem Israel. Besides all this, it's the third day since things happened. Why is it important? Have you ever been knocked out? What medically have you been knocked out? Have you been put to sleep? Are you aware of what's going on? But they don't generally. I mean, I've heard of surgeries that go 4 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours, 12 hours, and on occasion a little longer. But there reaches a limit. The medical experts tell me that there is a limit to how long they can keep you under that point of sedation. As one doctor described it to me one day, controlled poisoning. Just a little bit more and you're gone. A little bit less and you're awake during the procedure. But these people were like you and I. They could go to the cemetery and they could say, when did they put the body in there? He wasn't just knocked out. It's been 3 days. By human experience, he's not coming back. He's not coming out. He's dead. He's there. And these disciples were now talking to Jesus. And listen to the conversation. They go on and they give witnesses. Moreover, some of the women of our group astounded us. They arrived early at the tomb, and when they didn't find his body, they came and reported they'd seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they didn't see him. Then Jesus says, "How unwise and slow you are to believe in your hearts that all the prophets have spoken. Didn't the Messiah have to suffer these things and enter into his glory?" Let me step aside and we'll come back to that text in a moment. Did you hear about Andrew and Anthony Johnson in Chattanooga, Tennessee? The Chattanooga News, newspaper and television reported that these twin brothers, they were 63 years old, twin brothers, identical twins, they shared a house. You can research this. It's April 7th of this year. It was discovered that both men had died, twin brothers living together, both dead. They were discovered both dead in their chairs in their living room in the house that they shared. They were just sitting there. But part of the confusion over this is that by every indication, they'd been dead about 3 years. Nobody had gone up, knocked on the door, and gone in. Nobody had. Well, in fact, when the postal carrier was asked, "Why didn't you deliver mail there?" The post office said, "Because there was a note in the mailbox that said stop delivery." More to the story continues to be strange. They live in the same town as their 90-year-old mother, and you know, birthdays would come, and holidays like Christmas and Easter would come, and evidently they weren't a close-knit family because nobody checked on these two brothers. The experts say that they don't know whether it was a joint suicide where they did harm to themselves and took both their lives. They don't know whether it was a gas leak in the house. Somebody actually paid to have a lawn mowed periodically and the utilities kept on. It's a strange story, but it doesn't change the fact. There were the brothers in their own chairs sitting there, fossilized. For 3 years, they hadn't drawn a breath of life. They're is no doubt that they were dead. But we being human want to know, why did they die? How did they die? What caused them to stop breathing and their heart to quit functioning and their mind to shut down and then become inanimate objects? And then begin to decay and dry out. Andrew and Anthony Johnson, 63 years old, both discovered deceased. It's a strange thing, this thing of life. It involves death. And yet Jesus came and conquered death. He says to these two disciples, "How unwise and slow you are to believe and understand in your hearts that all the prophets have spoken. Didn't the Messiah have to suffer these things and enter into his glory?" And then in verse 27, he reads, "Beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted for them the things concerning himself in all the scriptures." Verse 28, "They came near the village where they were going, and he gave the impression that he was going to go a little further, but they urged him to stay. Stay with us, it's almost night, and the day is over. And so he went in to stay with them. It was as he reclined at the table with them. He took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. And then listen to this beautiful thing it says in verse 31. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. Remember, they were arguing, but look what it says in verse 32. It says, so they said to each other, weren't our hearts ablaze within us while he was talking with us on the road and explaining the scriptures? Explaining the scriptures. What's it look like or feel like when God's Holy Spirit speaks to you? Well, let me talk to you for a moment as if you're not a Christian. There are people who call themselves Christians that aren't. As one author once said, you can spend all your time in a garage and it doesn't make you a car. So I always like that. It brings a smile to my mind. Just because you say something about yourself doesn't make yourself true. You could declare yourself, I'm rich, and be poor. You could say, I'm beautiful, and the rest of us would smile and be gracious and not argue with you. But we wouldn't agree with you. You might say that you're handsome. And I know that you are because your mother always told you so, right? But the rest of us aren't biased with the bias and the love of a mother. You can say things about yourself that aren't true. You can call yourself a Christian. But I want you to understand the process by which a person becomes a Christian. It says in Romans 3:23 that all have sinned, even these little innocents that don't understand necessarily, those of you that have those smallest of children, let me ask you a question if you haven't already discovered. Who in the household is teaching them to be selfish, to take things and take it to their own self and refuse to share? Is someone teaching them that? Who in the house teaches a child to not tell the truth or to lie? Who in the house tells the child that it's okay to hit another person in anger or jest? Sometimes they strike out as if it's just an uncontrolled thing, and you look at them and they give you that look like, I know what I'm doing. All have sinned. All have sinned, and the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What that verse actually means is that Christ, who did no sin, is the example that God has given the world, and he says, aspire to be like my son. But the problem is all have sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. According to the Hebrew concept, the idea is it's like an archer takes an arrow out of his quiver and he knocks that arrow on the bowstring and he draws it to full draw and he releases that arrow, and the target being the holiness of God. And every one of us, given an opportunity in our life, we have fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23 says this. It's important that you hear this if you're not a Christian, but you call yourself a Christian or you say that I am a good person. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. There's a consequence for sin. It's a twofold consequence for a person that's not a Christian. First of all, there is physical death. And second of all, there is a condemnation, there's a guilt associated, and as a result of your sin, you will be judged by God and cast into outer darkness. Some of you will be old enough to remember Dr. Paul Harvey. I especially when I worked for a telephone company for 8 years, I would try and adjust my day so that I could be near a radio to listen to Paul Harvey every day. He just had an anecdotal way to tell you the bad news that the world was going to hell, but he would tell you in such a way that it was uplifting. He would tell you news that was sad and heartbreaking, but then he would lift you. And I always listened every year to Paul Harvey on Good Friday. Do you remember the story that he would tell about Dr. Gordon, the pastor? I don't remember the denomination being all that important, but a pastor like myself, Dr. Gordon, was in his study one day, a day not unlike today, and it was beautiful, and he got tired of studying, and he decided to walk around the church property, and he went outside into the alleyway, just walking around, and he spied a little neighborhood boy, one of those little boys that had that look. You know who I'm talking about. They just have that look. You can tell by looking they're up to something. And there in the possession of that little boy was a rusty birdcage. If you listen to Paul Harvey, do you remember that story? And he noticed that the little boy had the birdcage, and inside the birdcage was a sparrow. You think about sparrows. They're numerous. They're not pretty to look at. They don't have a beautiful voice. For those of you that are bird watchers, I don't think you'd travel very far, go with a club, sit with binoculars, hoping that you would see a sparrow. But Dr. Gordon walked over. The little boy had caught his attention, and he began a conversation with the child, and he said, "What do you have there?" He said, "I've got a sparrow. I caught him. He's mine. And what are you going to do with that sparrow? I'm going to play with him, and I'm going to torment him, and then I'm going to kill him." Dr. Gordon asked a question to the little boy, "Why do you want to do that?" And the little boy gave the profound answer, "Because he's mine. I can do with him as I please." Dr. Gordon said to the child, as he thought for a moment about the sadness of that picture and the heaviness that came to his heart, that this child was so focused on the destruction of life, that Dr. Gordon heard himself saying, "What would you take? What would you take to set that bird free?" Dr. Gordon, thinking he could get a deal, said to the little boy, "If I remember the story correctly, if not, forgive me." But it seemed like he offered him a small amount, perhaps a quarter, and the little boy said, "Oh, I wouldn't take a quarter for this." Dr. Gordon realized then that it wasn't going to be an inexpensive thing. And he asked the little boy, as he reached in his pocket, he pulled out a $5 bill, and he said, "Would you take $5? And the little boy said, "You bet." Dr. Gordon gave the boy his $5 and took the birdcage, a rusted birdcage. The cage itself wasn't worth $5. The sparrow surely wasn't. And Dr. Gordon opened the cage and, with some prompting and encouragement, set that sparrow free. And he stood there and he thought in his heart of hearts, that's what the devil does. He takes you captive. He torments you. He teases you. And the only price of exchange for the wages of sin is death is the perfect gift of Jesus' own life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. But how do you get that? What do you have to do? That's the crux of the issue. Have you ever heard that word, crux? Someone says that word. It actually, I think, is Latin for the cross. That's the cross of the issue. How do I get away from this death for my sin into everlasting life? I want you to look with me in Romans chapter. Make sure I give you the right number here. Romans 10. It would be good for you to look at that. And let me offer something. If you're here today and you don't have a Bible, if you don't own a Bible, if you don't have access to a Bible at your home, I haven't checked with anybody. I don't think I need to. If you need a Bible, will you take that Bible that's in your hands right now, take it home and consider it a gift, and we'll replace it. But in Romans 10 and verse 8, the writer, the Apostle Paul, says, "On the contrary, the message is near you in your mouth and in your heart." Along the way, like Cleophas and his friend, they had looked at the life and the story of Jesus, and their mind was spinning with a great deal of confusion. How is it that someone that walked like them and talked like them and ate bread and fish like them could be different than them? But the Holy Spirit says to us, on the contrary, what does it say? The message is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. And this is the message of faith that we proclaim. Now listen to this. If you confess with your mouth. That's what Cayley did. But in the original writing of the biblical language, that word could have been translated agree. If you agree with God. If you agree with God that you are a sinner. If you confess with your mouth that you are a sinner, but you also confess that this one called Jesus of Nazareth, or the Christ, He is Lord. Let's stay together for just a moment on that word Lord. I have a vehicle outside, and inside of my glove box. I guess that's what we still call them. I don't know. I don't keep gloves in a glove box. Anybody keep gloves in a glove box? I keep everything else in there. But if I were to ask you to go to your car and get in the glove box, most likely you'd get in the glove box. So you know where I'm talking about. In there is a document that says that I and my wife are the owners of that particular vehicle. There's also a small piece of paper that I'm required to carry. And if you don't have one, shame on you. It's called proof of insurance. Proof of insurance. And if you get pulled over, there's three things that you're supposed to have if you're driving. And that is your driver's license, proof of insurance, and your registration. You have to be able to demonstrate that that is yours and you are the rightful owner, occupier, and driver. But you know what's interesting with that driver's license and that certificate of registration and that proof of insurance? It doesn't mean you own the road and you can drive any old way you want to. I mean, you can, and perhaps some of you do. Just let me know where you're going to be so I can avoid that part of town. And oh, by the way, I used to be that person. I drove as if the road was mine. I gave no regard to stop signs. I didn't pay heed to speed zones, school zones, little kids. They're always making little kids. Let them get in the road and get in my way. It's too bad for them. It was a selfish and a selfless attitude that I lived because I said, it's my car. I've got my registration, my driver's license, and my proof of insurance. But you know, periodically along the way, there was an authority who would pull me over and ask me if I had a driver's license, registration, and proof of insurance. And I'd produce those documents, and he'd always bless me with another document. To a greater consequence, the Word of God says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, that He has the authority in your life, that He's not just your friend, He is your master, you live for Him, He is your life. He is not secondary to anyone, He is the very center of your soul. And believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, it says you'll be saved, you will be forgiven. Those lies that you tell, those things that you take, those words of hate, they'll be forgiven. I don't know about you, but that I'm like Cleophas and his friend at times. How can that be? You know, when the police officer gives you the ticket, at least you can go before the judge and plead your case. But invariably, he says, pay the clerk. You're going to have to give an accounting for your life. But God, blessed be God, He says, you can be forgiven of your sin. But look what it says in verse 10. With the heart one believes, resulting in a righteousness. And that is something that God does in you and for you. God does that. It's not the baptismal waters. It's not church membership. It is what God does. He changes you from being unrighteous to being righteous, to being unforgiven, to being forgiven. If you were a small child, from being naughty to being nice. And then it goes on to say, and with the mouth one confesses, and this results in the forgiveness of sin and life everlasting. So those of us that call ourselves Christians at some point in our life, and to me that's what this day of resurrection does. It causes me to stop and be mindful of my own sin. Past, in my past, my own sin. But not only in the past, before I came to Christ, even since I've come to Christ, I've sinned. But the burden's been lifted. The guilt associated with it and the power to do something about it rests with me. The sense of personal sin, and that all of us who say we are Christians at some point had to humble ourselves and say, I'm willing to be saved. You know, as a child, when I heard this, It didn't take me long to figure out I did not want to go to this place called hell. I had no interest in going there. And so as a child, I said yes, and I prayed that prayer. But then I began to realize that I was still me. And as I got a little older and moved out on my own, I began to do the things that I knew that I shouldn't do. And when I say I knew, I'm not just talking about the morals and the ethics that my parents taught me, but society said to me and about me, you shouldn't do those things. And for the Christian, you don't go back to Christ and say, save me again. You go back to Him in humility and you say, forgive me and restore to me your relationship. And to be able to do that, to have that kind of humility, means that you trust in Christ alone. You trust in Him alone. You don't trust in a denomination, not in a church. You trust in Christ alone. And this is what this writer is saying in Romans chapter 10. Says you invite Him personally to become your life. Life, L-I-F-E. As one author said one time, when you go to the cemetery and you look at the birth date and you look at the death date, oftentimes there's that little short dash. The writer said that's life. It's what you do in the in-between that birth and that death. With Christ. But listen to what we hear the scripture saying. The scripture says in verse 11 in Romans chapter 10, no one who believes on Him will be put to shame. And I read verse 13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The very word Easter, that word doesn't communicate. It's not an old word that has anything to do with the resurrection. It's a worldly word that we've hung on this event. But this event is an historic event. Historic in the sense that Christ lived, Christ died, God raised Him. There's a history in your life. A birthday. And along the way, as God has given you however many birthdays, you've reached a point, this point. I wish I could say something original sometime, but someone recently said in my hearing, you need to understand this, because they were in a conversation with someone who was giving them reasons not to do something. And they were using their age. They said to the person who said, I'm too old, you need to understand, you've never been this old before. And the other side of it that he said is you'll never be this young again. And in that moment, you need to decide, because along the way, this is what I know. After more than 37 years of preaching the gospel, the Holy Spirit is speaking to people right now. You know if He's speaking to you. You might not understand it. You might not be able to explain the rest of us. I don't like what I'm feeling. I don't like what I'm thinking. The Holy Spirit, like Jesus in the conversation with Cleophas, has come alongside and said, what's troubling you? And He's engaging you now. And it might be at this very point He's saying, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. Because I want you to hear this. Before you do that, it doesn't matter what the question is. The answer is Jesus. I don't have enough money. The answer is Jesus. Someone has left me. I'm alone. The answer is Jesus. I don't have a job. The answer is Jesus. But I want you to hear this, those of you that call yourselves Christians. It's sad about the church, but the reason our family and friends aren't impressed with Jesus is because we haven't lived every day, every moment, as if we're really impressed with Jesus. And we need to ask God to forgive us of that. And if there's someone here as we close the service with the invitation, if there's someone here that said, I think God is speaking to me. You come, we'll have people to counsel with you and to pray with you. There's someone here that says, I know that God has spoken to me, and this is what I must do. We offer the invitation that you might come forward as a memorial, that you could look back on April 20th, 2014, as a moment in your own history where you said, I either am coming to Christ for the first time, or I'm coming back to Christ because He saved me. Let us pray, and then we'll sing and extend the invitation. God, thank you for the resurrection, because in the resurrection, we see Christ lifted up as both God and man, victorious over death and forgiveness of sin to them that believe. Oh Lord, help us in our unbelief. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand together as we sing.